All right, well, here we go. Technology. I don't know. It's a shame that we couldn't do that. I would like quite a few pictures of Brother Dukas and myself that I'd like you to see. Pastor was going to try to set up a laptop that you can look at, but it would have been better while I was preaching. I could have referred to some of the things you could have been able to see, but that's not going to happen. And I see tonight that a lot of you here don't even know who he is. But we'll tell you. We drove, my wife and I drove just shy of 300 miles today. Had a snow blizzard yesterday afternoon. Dropped about 6-8 inches of snow, making the roads very treacherous. We planned on coming back last night and after the services, but that couldn't happen. I mean, it was really treacherous. It was really bad. And so it made the roads terrible. But this morning, the roads were still covered with snow and ice. Temperature was -9 when we left, and the high was supposed to be 4 degrees there. I guess we're getting about like that too here. But Gene and I left actually to go out there on Wednesday, this past Wednesday. We knew that the services or the viewing would actually be Friday, but we are, I'm going to tell you as we go how close we were with these people, and we wanted to be with Brother Dukes' wife and his children. And also had the details of the services that we had to figure out and what was going to happen. So we left on Wednesday to drive out. We stayed 5 days in an old-fashioned drive up to the door, Days Inn. I like to kind of drive up to the door. Remember that? It's unheard of anymore. Now you got to carry all your stuff in some box-looking building, find an elevator, walk down this hallway, that hallway, the other hallway. And it drives me out of my mind. I want to drive right up to my door, take my stuff in, and go to bed. Amen. So we found one of those in Monroeville, Pennsylvania, over near where Sarah, our youngest daughter, lives. And we like to stay there. We're in that area. When we're in that area, we're actually, how many miles from the church were we? About 35? Did you calculate the mileage from the motel to the church? Approximate?
Church, yes. 33.
33? Okay. So we're about 33 miles from that. That's about what we are from here when we come to church. It's just a little bit less than that probably. But so we stayed in that little hotel. Pastor Bissell, as he said, asked me to come tonight and give the exact message that I prepared for Brother Dukas' homegoing. I actually did a somewhat abbreviated version of what I'm going to give you tonight at the actual funeral, which took place at the Independent Baptist Church at Blairsville, Pennsylvania, where David has been pastoring for about the last 4 years. I'm going to give the whole message tonight, but I'm going to do it just as I did it there. I want you to understand that. And so sometimes I'm going to be making references to Brother Bucus's congregation and the deacons who are there by name. And so I'm doing this for a reason, so if you'll bear with me, I'm going to do it just like I did it. And I have preached literally thousands of sermons over the 41 years that I've been a preacher and been preaching, but this was by far the hardest message that I have ever given in my life. Yeah. It's certainly even harder for the family. Please, if you will, some of you here tonight don't know this family, and it's a shame you don't. It's really a shame. Some of you here didn't even get to hear Brother Dukas. He was here oftentimes over the years, and the last few years has had a lot of struggles with different issues and things. Spoke at our Hunter's Banquet all the time, way back when. There's tape recorded messages you can hear. Not a finer Bible expositor that I know than him, and he was a tremendous, tremendous preacher. But pray, if you would, if you'd remember, I'd appreciate it, for Susan, his wife of 47 years, and they knew each other for over 50 years. I think they went together 3.5 years and then got married, and they've been married 47 years. They have 3 children. Michelle is the oldest, David and Rebecca, and especially for his grandchildren. Pap meant so much to them. He spent a lot of time with the kids all the time, and if you knew Brother Bucus, he used to go to where his daughter would have the children, and he'd let the kids climb out the window, and he'd take them over to his house, make popcorn in the middle of the night when Mom, his daughter, thought they were in bed sleeping, and that's Bucus, that's the way he is. And so they did that all the time. They would get on their cell phones and say, "Pap, when you have popcorn, come over to your house." So he'd sneak over there and get them out of the window and take them to his house or take them somewhere. And that's just the way he was. But Brandon is a miracle child. He was born with his intestines totally out of his body, which most kids die from, born premature, and we prayed for Brandon years ago. Brandon's now 14 years old, and so Brandon's a blessing, and Brandon loves his Pat and misses him. It's horrible and horrendous to see the burden on these children. Timmy is the second son, Brandon's brother, and then Gavin is also a grandchild. Lonnie, Ava, and Max, and as the Lord would bring any of them to your mind, I'd appreciate your prayers for them. And so I'm going to give the service just as I did there, except this is the full version. I'm even hopefully going to get to the gravesite sermon that was a continuation of my sermon. And by the way, Brother Bissell, it worked out well, much better than I thought it was going to, with the time limitations and so forth. I got most of this in, but I'm going to give it to you the way I prepared it. I prepared it in manuscript form. I sometimes preach that way, but oftentimes I just preach from notes that I write. But this was a full manuscript written out, and so I want to give it to you the way the Lord laid it upon my heart. And I think if you'll listen, even though many of you did not know Brother Vucish, I think it'll be a blessing to you, and I think you'll learn much from it. I'm going to talk about our relationship a lot. You'll learn what he means to me. And again, I wish those pictures were able to be shown, because some of them are pretty funny pictures too. But if you get a chance, when we get done here about midnight, you can look at the slideshow of Brother Bissell gets it running back there. Okay, so I'm going to open just like we did at the service yesterday. It was around quarter till 11 when we began, and this is what we did. I announced that the Vucish family would like to thank all of you for your presence at this homegoing celebration honoring our beloved brother, Pastor David Vucish. My name is Peter Accardi, and I have served as an evangelist for 41 years, just a little longer than I have known Brother Vucish. And then I ask the folks to bow their heads, as we're going to do tonight, and pray. Lord, we thank you so much for Brother Dave. We thank you for the impact he had on, I thank you for the impact he had on my life, and we thank you for the impact that he had on many of the lives represented even here tonight in this place. And Lord, I pray that you'd give all who will take place in this service today strength and enable us to accomplish your will here today. For your word says, without you, we can do nothing, and we acknowledge that is so. Help us, Lord, to communicate things that will be expedient, profitable, and necessary. Help me, especially, to eliminate any meaningless drivel that would not edify those who you have gathered here today. Thank you for Brother David, for the privilege it has been to know him, and for the impact, again, that he's had on many lives represented here today. May what we say be pleasing to you and represent what he would have said if he could speak to us today according to your will and your word, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. God is speaking to all of us here this day, and that he wants to teach us all lessons in these matters of life, in these things of life, the importance of life, the frailty of life. In Psalm chapter 39, verses 4 and 5, and even 7, if you want to look there just for a second, Psalm chapter 39, verse 4, the Lord, it says, Lord, make me to know mine end, and the measure of my days, what it is that I may know how what, folks? Frail I am. And indeed we learn of our frailty as we observe what took place in our dear brother's life. The verse 5 says, behold, thou hast made my days as a handbreadth, and mine age is as nothing before thee. Verily every man at his best state is altogether vanity. Selah. Verse 7, and now, Lord, what wait I for? My hope is in thee. Amen, amen, amen. And I hope that's where your hope is this day, because we are indeed frail. And then we learn, as we observe what happened to our dear brother, of the brevity of life. James 4:4 says, whereas ye know not what shall be on the morrow, for what is your life? It is even a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanisheth away. Life is short, and the older we get, the shorter it seems it is. I remember when I was a young person, I heard David preach a message along these lines. When you're 15 waiting to be 16 so you can drive a car, it's like an eternity till it's going to happen, amen? But when you get 63, 64, 65, it's like, whoo, what happened, man? The next one's coming right around the bend. And so life is short. And this event, some of you here tonight don't realize, but those who were there realized that it was shockingly fast. And within a 3-week period, a man who was walking around like you and me was taken home by God Almighty. And what we learn and how we react to the teaching that God has for us in these things will be crucial in our life. My brother David left us a wealth of information that we can glean from in trying to contemplate the things that have happened to him over the last few days. He left 2 books that he wrote, one called Elemental Theology, a survey of the Bible's basic doctrines. He left another book that he wrote and penned and called it Ministering Spirits, the Doctrine of Angels. And we've had those books here. Some of you may have them at your home today as we meet tonight. We've had them, many of them, I'm sure, we printed here. But Dave didn't publish the book, as I would have hoped he would. He just made that book available to a select few, and we were privileged to be able to have access to that. All of David's sermons were written out in full detail. Every sermon he preached was a manuscript. But you'd never be able to tell that he was reading it. Never, ever, ever. There's not, wasn't a man that could read a sermon and preach it, and you'd never, ever know he was looking at a note than David. It was unbelievable. But all of his sermons were written out in full. So there are volumes of sermons over these years that he has recorded in handwritten fashion. And they're available, and I'm encouraging his family to even publish those. They would be very valuable, have very valuable teaching in them for anyone who would read them. Then there are recordings, tapes, which we have many of right here in our church, and they also at the Independent Baptist Church where this message was indeed preached, where David was buried. He had tapes and CDs, and though it will be very hard if you knew him to listen, if you want to know what he thought was best for you and I at this time, now that he's home with the Lord, you'll get some of these things and absorb them and listen to what he preached. The things that he believed and said and taught when he was with us will be of great value and comfort to us now if we will but listen to what he said or read what he left us. He is a Bible teacher par excellence. You won't find a better one anywhere, any place. You see, David Vucish and I were more than just close friends. I felt as if he were the physical brother that I never had. We had a bond that was beyond friendship, like David and Jonathan in your Bible. I have known him for about 40 years. We talked on the phone most every day, and oftentimes a few times a day, multiple times. So if there was a day when we didn't talk, the multiple talks covered all the ones when we didn't talk. And we talked, I'm sure, every day for the last 40 years that we've known each other, pretty much so. He knew me warts and all, and yet he accepted me, remained my friend, and always encouraged me. He carried me unselfishly through some of the deepest, darkest trials of my life. He married my oldest daughter, Jennifer, and her husband. And he was there when she was born in a snow blizzard in Tunkhannon, drove over those hills. He lived in this area and came to see us the day and the morning she was born. David played a major part in Lisa and Steve's wedding, my second daughter and my son-in-law Steve, as he came and was the, what do you call it, the at the reception. I forget what you call it, the speaker or whatever. What do you call it?
Master
of ceremonies. That's it, MC. And he played a big part in Lisa and Steve's wedding. He was going to marry my youngest daughter, Sarah, because Sarah loved Brother David, but also because the guy she married, Paul Abraham, grew up in David Vucish's church. That's how my youngest daughter met Paul Abraham. Paul went to David's school, Youngwood Christian Academy, years ago, and met Sarah, and then years and years later, it's strange how that worked, the Lord brought them together, and they got married. David was very concerned that he would offend their uncle, Brother Bissell, and that wouldn't happen. Brother Bissell knew that, and knew that Paul Abraham was from there. So Brother Vucish wrote me a letter and said, the only thing I don't want to do is offend Brother Bissell. And I assured him that would not be the case. And so he agreed to marry Paul and Sarah. But he got hit with a bout of prostate cancer right at that time, and was taken to the hospital for a major surgery to remove his prostate. So of course he was not going to do that. And Brother Bissell did marry Sarah and Paul, which was a blessing. And we have that on video too. Then my son Joseph married Jamie, who's from Indiana, and the dirty crook made us all drive out to the state of Indiana. Amen. So Brother Fugis didn't make that one. But he had a major impact on all of my children and all of my family, my wife and myself. I have known his children since Michelle, his oldest daughter, was somewhere between 4 and 6 years old, which would have made David, his son, his only son, somewhere between 2 and 4 years old. And Rebecca wasn't thought of at the time when we met them. And so I watched them all grow up for most of their lives. And Susan, his wife, what a lady. What a blessing she has been to me. What an example of the virtuous woman of Proverbs 31. Amen. Married again 47 years. They went together for 3.5 years. They stayed together for over 50 years. That's unheard of in this day and age that we live in today. Yeah. But Susan is a queen. She's a wonderful lady. And David and I used to laugh. We had so many similarities about us. And I'm going to talk more about that as I go on. But our wives had many similarities also. And that's an absolute fact. It's unbelievable. Like, for instance, I want 2 of everything. So when I get down to 1, we get more. So you got to be at least 2. And when I go to the cabinet to get something and it's not there, she didn't listen. Well, Susan didn't either. Same thing. I'm just kidding. She did the same thing. And they had many similarities like that and many others. And I know that David also had great impact on many of you also who are here today. I know many of you by name who I never have met personally because of his love and respect for you, and also through sharing with me through church emails. I heard the name Bill Young, the chairman of the deacon board at Brother Vucish's church at Independent Baptist Church. And I was sent pictures of a big hunt in Wyoming where Bill Young went and shot a 6x6 elk in Wyoming a few miles way back in the wilderness somewhere and quartered it out and drug it out. And Bill said that he says getting kind of old for that now these days. But I heard that story, and I heard many stories. And I heard how Bill Young was such a blessing to my dear friend and brother, Brother Vucish. Bill Young is an engineer. And loves to hunt and stuff, and you just told me about him till I felt like I knew him. Paul West, another deacon in that church, I heard that name. And then I heard of Deacon James George, a young man that Brother Vucish led to the Lord. And Brother Vucish would tell me time and time again how he wanted to groom Deacon James George to be a preacher and a pastor. And he thought that God had called this young fellow to the ministry. I heard Brother Vucish tell me that and didn't doubt him a bit, because I know Brother Vucish wouldn't say that just at a quick whim. But on the way home, as we drove back here this afternoon, the sound man at the church gave me 2 messages that Deacon James George preached. He's not just a deacon, that's his name, Deacon, D-E-K-E-N, James George. And he gave me 2 messages. This young man preached. He's about 30 years old. He was a commercial airplane pilot and gave all that up and has given his heart to the Lord. And I want to tell you, he's never had any formal instruction in any Bible college or university, only sitting under Brother Vucish. And I didn't realize until I listened to the messages how the hand of God is indeed on this young fellow. What a blessing it was. And God's given the young man a voice to preach. And he's given him the ability to study, obviously. Brother Vucish got him a course called the Schofield course. It's actually a course, not just the Schofield Bible. It's a full course that Brother Vucish had taken years ago. And he got it for Deacon, and Deacon was studying. Now, Deacon, pray for Deacon, because he's just like a lost sheep. He doesn't know where to turn now. Brother Vucish was his teacher. He was his mentor. And I want to tell you, he's an exceptional young man. A good preacher, and God's going to use him if he keeps on course. Then I heard of the Welsh family, Jesse and Patty. I met Patty at the house over with Susan just when we first came in and didn't realize who she was, but I know her because I pray for her, and so have some of you here at this, my church at Elkdale Baptist in West Clifford, PA. If you'll remember, Jesse and Patty had a little girl named Jordan, a granddaughter. And she had cancer. She's in our prayer list. She had cancer in her eye. She had to have her eye removed. And she's been undergoing chemotherapy, and what a horrid situation they've gone through these last few days. Little Jordan almost died and went home to be with the Lord. And she's right now, her autoimmune system, as we speak, is taxed because of the chemotherapy. And you want to keep praying for little Jordan. But I heard all of these names, J.B. and Carla, J.B. being the sound man in the church, Carla being a piano player and a member of the church that Brother Dave loved and talked about so much. And then Pat McClintock, which is J.B.'s mother, and he talked about her. Then a man named Bart, who preached Brother Vucish's funeral along with I. He had the eulogy in the morning service, and Brother Bart Greatock, his wife Joan. And I heard much about him. Bart's a cook. Though he was never trained as a chef, he's a master cook. And he makes all kinds of fancy food. And Brother Vucas wanted me to get together with Bart and talk about cooking, because I kind of fooled around with him a little bit. But Bart is way ahead of me, I guarantee it. And I felt like I'd known him for a long time. And then I heard the name Len and Patty Reeves. Leonard Reeves was a member of that church and a deacon. And Leonard, one day, they left the church service on a Sunday, I believe it was, and they went to a barbecue together, and Leonard was sitting there with a bunch of guys fellowshipping, and he always wore a big hat because he didn't want the sun coming down on him. He had problems with skin cancer and stuff. I believe that was what it was. And the guys were talking to him, and the next thing, Leonard didn't respond. And they said, Leonard, they went over there to see, and he was gone. He just went to be with the Lord just that quick. The heart just stopped. And he was a good, healthy, he was a hunter. He used to go overseas and hunt. And he'd go to hunt doves. And where is it? There's a place to hunt doves somewhere out there where there's all kinds of doves. Where's a big dove hunting place? Oh, New Mexico, maybe? Something like that, I believe it is. And he'd shoot doves with a 410 shotgun. And quite a guy. But I never met Leonard that I remember. But I felt like I knew him. I did see Patty at this funeral and met her finally, but I felt like I knew her. And I'm sure I didn't mention all of those who Brother Vucas mentioned in that congregation and spoke so highly of over the years, but I feel like I'm almost back home at my church in Elkdale. Of course, tonight I am, but I felt like I was there too, just to let you know. Nobody taught more Bible doctrine and theology with David Vucas than me. If he could speak to us right now, he would be telling us and teaching us what he himself stated so well in his book on elemental theology. On page 11 of that book, my brother David said, God is equitable, fair, and righteous in dealing with men. Acts 17:31. I'm reading from my brother's book, and so he's telling us that he believes God is independent, free, autonomous. He does as he pleases. David said, God knows all things, actual or possible. Matthew 10:29, 11:21, Acts 15:18, 1 John 3:20. God always does what's best for mankind. The greatest display of his attribute of love is the death of Christ for unworthy sinners. Jeremiah 3:5, John 3:16, 1 John 4:8. God is sovereign, in control, ruling his creation, Isaiah 46:10. That's on page 13 of Elemental Theology. And then Ephesians 1:11, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will. And David believed that, and he believed even his death was worked after the counsel of his own will. I know that for a fact. I know him ever so well. We often talked together of the emptiness and vanity of show business and the entertainment world, which he experienced as a road manager with a very popular rock and roll band who had many hit records out on the market. And I, as a rock and roll performer, and how wonderful we said how wonderful it was that God showed to both of us the truth of, for what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his own soul? We talked about that often. Back in the early days, people used to mistake David and I for each other. I preached in a Bible college chapel, and later that day, one of the professors in the school stopped David in the hallway to commend him on the message that he had preached, though he didn't preach it, I did. And David let him go on about 10, 15 minutes, laughing down inside the whole while, never told the guy it wasn't him to preach. He came and told me, and we laughed about it. I remember one time I was called to preach in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Of course, that's right near where David's from. He's from New Alexandria, which is about, maybe 40 miles from Pittsburgh. So I, being in Pittsburgh holding meetings, David wanted to come see me, so he did. We had a meeting, and they had a fellowship after the service downstairs, but I didn't get to go down because I was counseling some people that came forward. And so at that time in my life, I was having some physical problems, and the doctor advised me to stop eating sweets and the sugar things. I didn't have diabetes or anything, but I had different things that were issues in my life. So the doctor gave me a strict diet and told me this is going to help me. And so I used to, I used to be booked 3 years in advance, not solid, but I'd be booking out 3 years. And I used to send this piece of paper out telling the people, because every lady in every town, every place, breakfast, lunch, and supper, they want to make me the gooeyest, fanciest cake, you know. They all want to show me what kind of things they can bake and the cookies, and I got to stop, see. So I sent a thing, and I do love fruit. I'd rather eat fruit than candy anyway, or cake. And so I sent this thing out, and I explained it. I explained it as kindly as I could that, you know, I travel so much, I got to be very careful with this. And I sent this out, and of course, some people trouble, and some people thanked me tremendously. We didn't know what to make you, and now we at least we've got an idea what to do. And some people were blessed by it. That's the right attitude. Some people had a problem with it. But I came to this church in Pittsburgh, and we had the meeting Saturday night. I probably preached from Wednesday to Sunday. And so I'd been preaching meetings, and Dave came on Saturday, and there was quite a few youth there. They had the fellowship downstairs. And so I was counseling some people that came forward. And Dave left that night. I said goodbye to him, and he was gone. And that Sunday morning comes, and Pastor and I in the church are meeting for prayer just before the morning service. And this lady in the church comes in with this big tray of cheesecakes, all gooey, icky cheesecakes with cherry stuff all over them and all kind of sweet stuff running all over. She's got this big tray. Comes right in the office. The pastor's standing there. I'm standing there. She goes, "Here, Brother Accardi, I heard you love these." And the pastor was so embarrassed because it was like it was a shock about my little list. See, it was said I don't even eat those things. And the pastor got all red-faced. The lady just turned around, marched out of the office. He goes, "I don't know what in the world possessed her to do that, Brother Accardi. She knows you don't eat that stuff." And, you know, we got the paper, and he's trying to apply. I said, "Oh, don't worry about it." I said, "It don't matter. You know, I couldn't figure that either." So I was befuddled about that. Later, I was telling my wife about this lady and what had happened. And my wife said to me, "Didn't you tell me Dave Vucish was there last night?" I said, "Well, yeah." She said, "Well, call him up and ask him if he went downstairs to the fellowship where they had the goodies." I called up. I said, "Dave, yeah." I said, "Were you down? Did you go down to fellowship downstairs after the..." "Oh, yeah." He said, "They had these cheesecakes down there, man. There was cherry all over them. Man, were they dynamite. I almost ate the whole tray." And so the mystery was solved. Back then, he looked a lot like me. Some of the pictures that you'll see on that slideshow, you'll see that. And we had a similarity anyway. When I first came to Baptist Bible College in Clark Summit, I met a young man named John Ramey. Now, here's how the Lord works. Dave Vucish is from Pittsburgh. Dave Vucish, at 18 years old, he had met a girl earlier, about 15 years old he was. He met Susan. And they went together, but her father was a believer. And he didn't like Dave, and rightly so, because Dave was on the other side of the fence. And so he insisted that if he's going to date his daughter, if Dave's going to date his daughter, Susan, he has to go to church. So David went to their church and met a guy named Pastor Webb, who was trying to win David to the Lord. And so this Pastor Webb would come to the house to visit Dave all the time, and Dave would go out the back door, tell his mother, tell him I ain't here, and he would go out the back door, and his mother would tell him he wasn't there. One time, he tells us on one of his tapes, and I think we got it somewhere around here, he tells he got the Hong Kong flu, and he was sicker than a dog, nigh on to death. And it's a funny thing, the Lord saved him in a tremendous virus and flu, and took him the same way at the end of his life. It's kind of interesting, but I had the Hong Kong flu, and Webb comes on that day. And so the mother tells Webb that the guy, he's sick upstairs, figuring he's not going to go up there and get germs. He goes, "Oh, that's good. I want to see him." So the preacher goes up there, gives Dave the gospel message. I'm going to try to make it as short as I can. And Dave received the Lord and got gloriously saved. Amen. He got saved that day, 18 years old, in his bedroom. Pastor Webb, Susan's pastor, led him to the Lord. Well, wasn't too long after that, him and Susan got married. It was just shortly after that. And they took off and went to Anaheim, California, the other side of the United States. He got out there and he was still rough around the edges. He had just gotten saved. And Dave's pretty rough around. If you know Dave, you'll understand. I mean, he was quite a guy, quite a character. And he goes out there and he's not doing everything he should be doing. He's saved, but he's got a lot of rough edges. So he gets hooked up with a church out there in Anaheim, California, with a pastor named Art Rainey. Art Rainey has a son named John Rainey. In fact, it's John Calvin Rainey. His middle name is Calvin. So John Rainey, the son of Art Rainey, came to Baptist Bible College, Clark Summit, Pennsylvania. But David Vucish went from Pittsburgh to Anaheim, California, got in Art Rainey's church. Somehow, it was actually through his desire to play sports that he got connected with this church. And he said he was with this baseball team and they're singing Archie or something. He's wondering what in the world. He just loved to play sports. He was a Christian, but it was kind of crazy to him. The songs they were singing, Father Abraham and all that kind of stuff. And you just never heard anything like that. But he got in Art Rainey's church, and Art Rainey was a good, good preacher. We played a tape one time here. When Art Rainey died, he died preaching in his pulpit, and it was on tape when he died. He was having a stroke. And I played it here one time, and it's probably still in the archive somewhere. Dave gave me that tape. As he's preaching, he's saying, "Folks, I'm getting numb in the hand. I think I'm really having a stroke." He's telling his people, and he laid down on the platform and went home to be with the Lord. That really happened. That's how Art Rainey went home to be with the Lord. Lord's good, amen? Lord always tells us he's doing the work. And if we just open our eyes and look and see. And so here's John Rainey over here having met David Vucish because David came into his dad's church. And I meet these kids and they come over to my house to fellowship a little bit. I just came to Bible college and they giggle and they laugh. They go, look at the mannerism. I said, "What are you talking about?" They said, "You look just like, you talk just like, you act just like this guy that's at my dad's church out in Anaheim, California." I said, "Well, who's that?" "David Vucish." And they're telling him the same thing about me. They're writing him letters and stuff. And so he's hearing about me, and I'm hearing about him, but he's in California. Well, he's out there about another year or two, maybe. And then he grows in the Lord in Anaheim, California. He comes back to the Pennsylvania. He takes a ministry in Fairless Hills, Pennsylvania. That's just probably about, maybe 12 miles from where I grew up, in Langhorne, Pennsylvania, down below here. And he's a youth pastor in Fairless Hills. Then I'm traveling along the course of my ministry, and I come to a camp called New Life Island in New Jersey. And Vucish brings a youth group to that camp for the week of meetings that I was holding in New Life Island. This is the Lord. This can't be an accident. And I'm preaching one night, and after I get done preaching, here comes this guy up to me. And he said, "I heard a lot about you." I said, "Oh, yeah." I said, "Well, don't believe a word of it." And he said, "Well, I don't know." He said, I heard." He said, he said, "You know John and Shelley Ramey?" I said, "Yeah." And he said, "My name's Dave Uke." I said, "Oh, man, you got to be kidding me. You're the guy that everybody said, yeah." He said, "They said the same thing about that, me to you as you to me." And so there was another incident where we reminded them of each other. Some of you don't know him, and I wish you did, because we both have very strong personalities, they said. But we never threatened one another. We never intimidated one another. You see, if we were on two different sides of any issue, which was rare occasion, but sometimes if we get on two sides of any given issue, people would hear us talk and think we were having a knockdown dragout. They think we were fighting. I mean, we scream and holler and carry on. People get nervous, you see. And I remember when he used to challenge me on the subject of the King James Bible years ago. I used to give him all the arguments that my seminary professors were feeding me, and would get so loud that people would get nervous. Susan talked about it when I was visiting with her at the house these days. My mother used to get real nervous whenever she heard Brother Lucas and I talking, especially on this King James Bible, see? You see, folks, I left my successful career in show business based on what God had done in my heart through what I believed was His infallible Word. I was just starting to get a little disillusioned by my professors at Bible college when I met David. I had believed from the start that God's word was inerrant, infallible, preserved without error. And now that was being challenged in Bible college. And that's a shame, isn't it? But that's what happens. And you see, I was very happy when I was in the world. I was successful in show business. I've said that here before. And that's a fact. It was my life. It wasn't something I just did on a weekend for an extra dollar bill. It was my life. But if somebody played a trick on me with this book, they played a real bad trick, because I was on top of the world. I had wine, women, song, made money. My records were selling. I was doing good. We were progressing. And everything was A-OK. So, and the same with you, I know, but I didn't care about you. Somebody played a trick on me with this. They played a dirty trick, amen? Now, I knew something had happened in my heart. So I'd give Dave a hard time, as he would tell me, about the infallibility of the King James Bible. I gave him a hard time, hoping that he really had the answers, and I'd give him all the things my professors were giving me to see if he could answer them. Well, he had the answers, and he would give them back to me with great guns, man. I mean, he had dynamite. He was exploding with the answers for me. We used to laugh and say that one day we were going to get old and be in some nursing home together with drool running down our faces, screaming and hollering at each other and shaking the whole place up, amen? The Bible says, iron sharpeneth iron. So a man sharpeneth the countenance of his friend. Much of my dullness has been finally honed and sharpened by my dear friend. I will miss him immensely, and so will many of you. David and I talked about dying, oftentimes. And Dave had many incidents in life that made him think about these things. I remember years ago when he traveled to India to Singapore in order to smuggle a large amount of money in a money belt to some missionaries over there, along with Dave Sproul, who's preached here years ago. When he was there, he contacted a virus that gave him such a high fever that he became delirious and thought for a while that he was not going to make it even home. I think his temperature was up around 104, and they thought he had something like malaria. It was something really, really bad. Then after that, when he did come home, he had a few bouts with something that caused him to drastically lose weight. He would eat and eat and eat, and he'd be losing weight. He was actually starving while he was living. He'd try to eat ice cream and try to eat anything he could, and they gave him some kind of cancer medication a couple times. They didn't find any cancer. They gave him an appetite, and he came back around. It happened to him twice, and it was devastating. He almost looked like a skeleton. But they never really put their finger on what it was. Then came the prostate cancer, and he had it good. And in all of these things, as he would go through this, His greatest concern, as he talked to me, was always for his dear wife, his children, and especially his grandchildren, who he loved more than life. David would say to me, Peter, when we die, people are going to say, oh, isn't that a shame? I'm so sorry to hear he passed away. And in the next breath, they're going to say, please pass the mashed potatoes. And they will go on with their lives and just forget all about us. He would say, you really can't blame anybody for that. It's just the way life is. Life's got to go on. But they're going to say, pass the mashed potatoes, man, and we're going to be forgotten. Though we had very much in common, as I've been sharing, we were very different in many ways. I never had an affinity to sports at all. I mean, some people call hunting a sport. Hunting is not a sport. Hunting is a man's work. Amen? That's what I believe. I don't believe hunting is a sport. Football is a sport. Baseball is a sport. Basketball is a sport. You know, hockey is a sport. That's sports. Hunting's something different. But I love hunting. I hunt, fish, shoot, preach, hunt, fish, and shoot. Some people think I do it all up here, but that's about all I do. But David loved sports, and he was very competitive. He used to tease me all the time when he would call me. He'd bring up names of great, great sports figures who everybody knows, and I didn't have a clue about it. He talked to me about the score in a certain game, like most of you guys know what's going on. I didn't have a clue, and he'd laugh, and he'd just say, well, what'd you think about the Steelers and the whoever, I don't know, the Mongrels, I don't know, and whatever they did today, and he'd just laugh and laugh and laugh, and got a kick out of the fact that I had absolutely no clue about sports. Whatever Dave took upon himself to do, he would do to the very best of his ability, and with all of his heart. There is a passage in the book of Corinthians that reminds me of his love for souls, and his zeal to run, compete, and win the prize, and his sport bending. It's found in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 19 through 25. And you ought to look there and look at this with me just for a minute. This passage reminds me a lot of David. It says, for though I be free from all men, yet have I made myself servant unto all. And I've seen that in David's life. That I might gain the more. And unto the Jews I became as a Jew, that I might gain the Jews. To them that are under the law, as under the law, that I might gain them that are under the law. To them that are without the law, as without the law, being not without the law to God, but under the law to Christ, that I might gain them that are without the law. To the weak I became as weak, that I might gain the weak. I have made all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. And this I do for the gospel's sake, that I might be partakers thereof with you. I'm going to stop there and give you an illustration of why I believe that is like David. Just a few weeks, must be maybe 2 months ago, he was coming down a street, a back road, two lane, and there was a pickup truck coming the opposite direction as he. And they were going around a bend, and the fella in the opposite other pickup truck was going very fast, came over too close into the other lane where Brother Vucish was running, and the two mirrors whacked and took Brother Vucish's mirror clean off the truck. Now, his mirror is not just glass mirror. It's a pretty new truck, and it's got all kind of electronics in it. And so it cost somewhere around $125, $150 for the mirror. And the mirror was laying in David's side of the road. When he looked back, he said, well, it's pretty clear which side of the road this all went down on. It went right down where I was riding, well into my lane. And so the other guy went down there about 100 yards, and he stopped when he was sitting in his car. So Dave said, well, he ain't getting out. I better go down there and see him. He told me the story, and he went on down there, and the guy got to the car, and the guy snarled at him, going kind of fast, weren't you? And Brother Vucas said, well, I didn't think so, but you came over a little too close, and our mirrors collided, and my mirror's laying back here in the road. Well, I think you came over on my side of the road. He comes right back at him snapping. And so David just kind of talked to him kindly for a few minutes and kept on talking. And guy was going round and round. And David said, I seen you around here. You're from this neighborhood, aren't you? He said, yeah, I'm from this neighborhood. He said, well, I pastor the Independent Baptist Church right over here in Blairsville. Oh, yeah, he said, I know where that church is. You see, Dave wanted to make sure the guy knew who he was and where he was. And he talked to him a little bit and got his first name, I think, but didn't get any more information. And he said to the guy, well, Bob or Bill or whatever the name is, he said, well, let's go home. Reached out and shook his hand and said, let's go home, Bill. And the guy said, that's what you want to do? And they said, well, no, that's not what I want to do, but that's obviously what we're going to do, aren't we? Let's go home. And the guy just looked at him. And Dave's telling me this story. I said, well, Dave, you should have called a cop. I mean, you should have got a cop would have been able to figure that out real quick. You got to pay for your own mirror, a couple $100. He said, Brother Cardi, I seen that truck around the neighborhood. I know the guy lives somewhere around here. I passed the church over there. How in the world am I ever going to have a ministry to that man if I would have taken him to the bank for a stupid mirror? Now, Brother Vucas usually is not just out there giving money away. But that was the Christian thing to do. And he said that. Isn't that what the Christian thing is to do, Peter? Like he did often to me. And I said, well, brother, I said, you just rebuked me because that probably ain't what I'd have done. Amen. But that's what he did. And so, this I do for the gospel's sake, that I might be a partaker thereof with you. That's a good illustration of that. Amen. Now, here's the verses I'm trying to get to. 1 Corinthians 9:24. Know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize. So run that ye may obtain. And every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it, that's people in the world do it, to obtain a corruptible crown, the runners in a race. But we, an incorruptible. You see, folks, the Apostle Paul often used sports analogies when he talked about discipleship and serving the Lord. He said that we as Christians are as running in a race. And the Holy Spirit of God, through Paul, encouraged us to run in such a way as to win. This is what David always wanted. And would want for all of us today. The Christian life is often depicted as running a relay race. As runners on God's relay team, we are currently, at this time, in a season that could be compared with what is called the exchange zone. The time when the baton is passed to the next runner in a relay race. The purpose in any relay is to maximize the strength and ability of one runner to the point at which he is spent and has a need for someone else to carry the baton and continue the race. In a true relay, the exchange zone is a small space that only allows limited time for the baton to be passed. Early exchange results in disqualification from the race. Late exchange ends in the same disastrous results. And so does dropping the baton from a lack of focus, a risk for both the passer and the receiver. When it is time to pass the baton to the next runner, focus must be intense. At the point of transfer, more ground is gained in less time if the team is in shape. Only in holding the baton too long does lost ground become unrecoverable. What one man can't finish alone, he hands off to another who can complete the task. Folks, please don't just say, pass the mashed potatoes. You see, as David passes the baton, I know him well enough to know for sure that he would want for you and I to pick up that baton and run as fast and as hard as we can, serving the God that he faithfully served and spent his life for in order to win the prize. In order to do this, you'll first have to be sure that you know the same Savior that David knows. Now, face to face. The only true God and Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. My brother David was definitely supernaturally transformed, not by religion or some fairy tale, but by a real relationship with the true and living God. He was a sinner, and some of you are his family. You know his warts as he knows mine. He was a sinner saved by grace, not perfect, but perfected in Christ. Amen. Perfected in Christ. There's no other explanation for him. You may not want to admit it, but for anyone that knew him, you'd know that he had a supernatural insight, understanding, and ability to communicate the Word of God. His teaching was always biblical, logical, very understandable. He could make profundity simplicity. Anyone with ears to hear should have understood everything that he taught. His presentation was always clear and precise. He loved God and his Word. He never earned a complete theological degree in any one given school, I don't believe. He went to Biola University for some time, took courses that he wanted to take. Came to Baptist Bible College in Clark Summit, took quite a few courses, and did well that he wanted to take. But David Vucish read and reread and absorbed all the great works that those who hold theological doctorates read and read. He read them, and he marked them. He read Chafer's Systematic Theology at least over, I'm sure over a half a dozen times. It's about a 7-volume set on theology. And the books in his library were not just there as something to look at. He read them and absorbed them and retained the information in them. He used to make me crazy. He had a mind like a trap. He could remember things so well. He wrote the two books I mentioned earlier that really should have been published and made available, but he only shared them with a select few. I mentioned the books earlier, Elemental Theology and Ministering Spirits. Now, folks, one of my seminary teachers who held a doctorate in theology wrote this letter to him after reading his manuscript on angels. I'm going to read that letter to you. This is a doctorate, a theological doctorate that taught in seminary. He says, "Dear Mr. Vucish, thank you for this manuscript. I put off reading it until yesterday and finished it today. I really have only positive thoughts for these 16 chapters. I believe you have the ideas worthy of perhaps a longer book. What you have done is to establish a most helpful biblical encyclopedia of sound exegetical analysis upon which the serious student can get a host of Bible references with enough direction to lay his groundwork and erect his structure. He need not fear he will go astray because you have fairly laid out his course. I profited greatly from my reading. I love theology. I'm no accomplished student in this particular field of study. I am using a pen because my shoulders have deteriorated and affect my hands. I was forced to lay aside typing for my hands for to sleep and hit keys I do not want. The other important subjects you included lend value and clarity. I did not find an area with which I would disagree, but I found ideas and presentations that were most inviting to give me a desire to go through your process so your presentations, David, can be my possessions as well. I gather this will be published. I shall want some copies of this when it is all done. Your table of contents is set up so I can go through with a subject idea and turn to the proper chapter. I was just called about an hour and a half ago to drive the school bus that I drive, so I'll get this in the mail. Thank you for your splendid work, Dr. Robert Williams, who pastored the Acre Lake Baptist Church for quite a long time. All of these things should prove reality and working of the true and living God to anyone who has eyes to see in this man of God. However, the Bible says very clearly that human beings who have not come to the Savior will do everything they can in their power to eradicate even the thought of God Almighty, the Creator of all things, which include the life that you are now experiencing. God gives you life, but people just reject God. It says the natural man received not the things of the Spirit of God, they are what? Foolishness to him. And Romans 1, it says, the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has showed it unto them. For the invisible things from him, from the creation of the world, are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Yet, so many people would just not be able to see. When you look at a man like Brother Vucish, who came from where he came, and how God gave him the insight and the ability to communicate the Word of God, you got to see the true and living God. Same with Brother Bissell, myself, anybody. If you told people that we were going to do what we do today, they'd laugh in your face. It's only by the grace of God. But, you know, people get overwhelmed with the evil and suffering that they see in the world, especially when God takes one, as he did our dear brother, so quickly. And they get coerced by the devil, the one who really is responsible for pain and suffering and evil. They get coerced by evil and wickedness to deny God in at these times of tragedy as they come into our lives. Even people who claim to be Christians do this. However, the minute you recognize there's something in the world as evil, and people do this, they say, well, if there's a God, how come David died so horribly and terribly and all those things took his life and all this evil in the world and what kind of a loving God? And they go on and on. But as soon as those kind of people with their mouths give assent to the fact that there's something as evil, then you're automatically assuming that there's such a thing as good. Amen? If you say, why does God create all this evil? Or why is all, excuse me, if there's a God, why is all the evil in the world? They're denying God. Now, if you acknowledge evil, then you have to acknowledge that there's good. And the minute you do that, you assume that, or postulate that there's such a thing as good, you're clearly establishing the fact that if these things exist, there must be some moral law or some standard whereby we can know what is in fact good and what is evil. When pressed as to how we decide what is evil and what is good, most unsaved people will say that they just know it inherently. They just know it because of their feelings. Well, do you know that in some cultures people love their neighbors, and in other cultures they eat their neighbors, both on the basis of feelings? You see, how in the name of reason can we possibly differentiate between good and evil on the basis of our feelings, especially when the Bible said we're depraved sinners? Whose feelings? Hitler's or Mother Teresa's? Whose feelings are we going to base this on, see? So for us to even recognize that there's such a thing as good and evil, we are obligated automatically to realize also that there has to be some moral law, some standard established somewhere that enables us to distinguish or tell between good and evil. Now, if there's a moral law, and obviously there is, we wouldn't even have it in us to be able to discern good and evil or have an idea of it, then there's got to be a moral law giver. And all of this leads us to the one that many people are trying to do away with and destroy or accuse him of being evil or unloving or unkind, and that is Almighty God. And he's given us those standards. And the Bible says that he's the light that lights every man. So that's how we know that there is indeed good and evil. But he's got to tell us what it is because we're messed up. Amen? So when running a race, some people falter by the wayside and into these traps of the devil. He works in their mind and makes them doubt God and say, how can there be a God? When he took my daddy, when he took Brother Vucish, the pastor of this church, and the people loved, and they really did love him immensely there. And how can there be a God to do this horrible thing? When running the race, some falter by the wayside into these traps of the devil as he works in the mind. The Bible says he's the God of this world who blinds the minds of them that believe not the gospel. Lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, as the image of God, should shine unto them. The devil works in your mind, and he gets at your mind, and he'll try to discourage you and cause you to doubt God. The Apostle Paul admonishes the people at the church in Galatia along these lines when he says in Galatians 5 and verse 7, and it also concerns the race we're talking about. Paul says, by the Spirit of God, ye did what? Do you have the text there? Ye did what? Ye did run well. Who did hinder you that you should not obey the truth? Galatians 5:7. Now, Matthew Poole was one of Brother Vucish's favorite commentators, along with Matthew Henry. And Matthew Poole, commenting on this verse, says, "This was once your faith, your profession, and according to this, you directed the course of your life and actions. Who hath hindered you in your course, or turned you out of the way, or given you a check in your race, and hath made you disobedient to, or swerve from, the truth which you formerly owned and professed?" So Christian people can fall off to the side in the race because some tragedy comes into their life. I would exhort you not to do that. Then verse 8 of Galatians chapter 5 says, "This persuasion cometh not of him that calleth you." And Matthew Poole said, this persuasion, this new opinion into which seducers have misled you, which by embracing it you have made yours, cometh not of him that calleth you. It's not from God who hath called you out of darkness into marvelous light, unto fellowship with himself, into a state of grace and favor with him, and to the hopes of eternal life, and who yet calleth you by his gospel. It must therefore be from the devil and his instruments, who go about to seduce you and pervert you. And so the Word of God, folks, clearly declares and mentions the race also. If you look at Psalm 19 and verses 1 through 6, the Word of God clearly declares, it says to the chief musician of Psalm of David, but here's what I want you to see. The heavens do what? Declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. Amen? You look out into those heavens. Day unto day, uttereth speech, and night unto night showeth knowledge. There's no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. Their line is gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them hath he set a tabernacle for the sun, which is as a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, and rejoiceth as a strong man to what?
Run a race.
His going forth is from the end of the heaven, and his circuit unto the ends of it, and there is nothing hid from the heat thereof. Bible said he's the light that lighteth every man, every one of you in this room tonight. Whether you acknowledge it or not, you have a light in you that you know that there is indeed a God. God is speaking and screaming at us from all areas of his creation. And yet men hold down the truth in their unrighteousness. It says, this was the light, that was the true light which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. John 1:9. You see, this incident with Brother Vucish has come upon us all so suddenly. My head spins. Our heads spin. Yet the Bible clearly tells us more about this relay race. If you look at Ecclesiastes 9:11, speaking of this relay race, it says in Ecclesiastes 9:11, "I returned and saw under the sun that the race is not necessary to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, neither yet bread to the wise, nor yet riches to men of understanding, nor yet favor to men of skill, but time and chance happeneth them to them all." In other words, folks, things don't always happen just the way they think they will happen, or according to how it looks like they should happen. And this certainly, in our eyes, as Brother Vucish goes to be with the Lord, seems like a tragedy. But Matthew Henry says about that verse, he says, "The preacher here in Ecclesiastes, for a further proof of the vanity of the world and to convince us that all our works are in the hand of God and not in our own hand, shows the uncertainty and contingency of future events and how often they contradict the prospects we have had of them. He has exhorted us in Ecclesiastes 9:10 to do what we have to do with all our might. But here he reminds us that when we have done all, we must leave the issue with God and not be confident of what we feel is success." Matthew Henry, one of David Vucish's most favorite commentators, said, "Solomon, the preacher, resolves all of these disappointments into an overruling power and providence, disposals of which to us seem casual." And that word means accidental. It seems like an accident, like in this case with our brother. "And we call them chance," as the verse says. But really, they are according to the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God, here called time. In the language of this book of Ecclesiastes, as Ecclesiastes 3:1 says, "To everything there's a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven." Time and chance happen to them all, the verse says. A sovereign providence breaks men's measures and blasts their hopes and teaches them that the way of man is not in himself, but subject to the divine will. We must use means, but not trust to them. If we succeed, we must give God the praise. If we be crossed, we must acquiesce, that means submit, in his will. Take our lot and trust. As the Ecclesiastes goes on, as the Solomon goes on, in verse 12 it says, for man also, what? Knoweth not his what? Time. You know, we don't know our time, folks. And, you know, we just don't know when God will take us home. It says, as the fishes that are taken in an evil net, as the birds that are caught in the snare, so are the sons of men snared in an evil time when it falleth suddenly upon them. I wonder how you will react if your husband is taken in an instant, like Leonard was at a barbecue after a church meeting, or like Brother David was in 3 weeks' time, right down the road to off to be with the Lord. I wonder, I mean, as I preach this message, going ho-hum, please pass the mashed potatoes, some of you probably are. But it says here, it tells us that man knoweth not his time, as the fishes that are taken in an evil net. God already told us it's going to happen that way. As the birds that are caught in the snare, and so are the sons of men snared in an evil time, when it falleth suddenly upon them. Matthew Henry said, we are often surprised with the evils we were in little fear of. Man knows not his time, the time of his calamity, his fall, his death, which in Scripture is called our day and our hour. We know not what troubles are before us, which will take us off our business and take us out of the world, what time and chance will happen to us, nor what one day or night may bring forth. It is not for us to know the times, no, not our own time, when or how we shall die. God has in wisdom kept us in the dark, that we may always be ready. Amen. Perhaps we may meet with trouble in that very thing wherein we promise ourselves the greatest satisfaction and advantage. As the fishes and the birds are drawn into the snare and net by the bait, laid to allure them, which they greedily catch at, so are the sons of men often snared in an evil time when it falls suddenly upon them before they are aware. And these things too come alike to all. Men often find their bane, their poison, their death, that means the word bane, where they sought their blessing, and catch their death where they thought to find a prize. Let us therefore never be secure, but always ready for changes, that though they may be sudden, they may be no surprise or terror to us. Amen, amen, amen. I hope you got that. God help us, folks, to not just say, please pass the mashed potatoes. Now, we got to pass the mashed potatoes. We got to eat. We got to go on. Our brother's home to be with the Lord. But don't just say, please pass the mashed potatoes. You see, God help us to do what it says in Philippians 2:16, and I want you to look at that one. Philippians 2:16. God help us to do this. Holding forth the word of life. That's what you got in your hands if you got a Bible tonight. You got the word of life, my friends. Holding forth the word of life. That I might rejoice in the day of Christ that I have not what? Run how? In vain. My brother David didn't run in vain. My brother David Vucish didn't run and waste his energy and run in vain and spin his wheels. I'm sure I'm standing here. Neither labored in vain. David didn't run in vain. He didn't labor in vain. God help us not to just say, please pass the mashed potatoes, but to pick up the baton and run. Hebrews 12:1 says, turn there and look at it. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us. And let us what, folks? You there? Hebrews 12 and verse 1. Let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be weary and faint in your mind. You see, folks, I'm going to say it again, to run in this race, you have to know the Lord, the master of the race, the Lord that David Vucish received at 18 years old. You have to get in the race. You got to get in there and run. You got to run, endure, and don't quit. You got to go to the end. You must win the prize. We're all very sad and we'll miss David immensely. But the Bible says, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. God help us not to just say, please pass the mashed potatoes, but to pick up the baton that Brother David passed to us and run with all of our might. At this point in the service, another man spoke, Bart Greatack. Did a tremendous job. Bart's only known Brother David for a short time. And I just met Bart. David told me much about Bart. David loved Bart. And I appreciated what he said, but I won't be able to communicate that to you. I think there is a CD that if you're interested in what he said, I will receive coming up along the way, and I'll make that available to anybody that would like it. But after this message that I preached, Bart spoke, and then we drove 12 miles to a graveside chapel where at least 75 people gathered. The funeral director said, in my wife's presence, he had never seen this many people in that chapel. There were many unsaved people in that chapel that David had witnessed to. A couple of men that would never darken the door of his church as much as he begged them and pleaded with them. He grew up with these fellas. He loved them. I could tell you a lot more about them. They were there. I know them. I had met them through David. I'm going to be in correspondence with them in the future. You pray for me as I indeed have to do with them. But you see, we went to this graveside chapel, and I'd like to close by sharing with you the short little ending that they asked me to give at the graveside chapel. Here's what I said as we came to the graveside. I didn't know if I could even be able to talk. My wife knows I was up every night pacing the floor, that if I'd be able to talk, Lord, help me to talk. If I just fall apart and cry, what's going to happen? I got to have strength, Lord. And so we talked one more time, and I said to the people, David and I always thought that he would do my funeral. We talked about it. I booked him. I asked him to have my funeral. And I told him to preach as long and as hard as he would desire. And I'm asking Brother Bissell right now if he'd do the same. I would want them both to partake in my funeral. And that may be soon. We don't know. My brother David was a year younger than me. But I told the folks that that was always what we laughed about and talked about as we did. But I never in a million years thought that I'd be standing there just yesterday doing his. Never in a million years. And so I said to the folks again, as I've said all through this message at the graveside, David was always a meticulous student of the Bible. He read and perused many books and volumes. When I hit that word perused, I had a laugh. Because him and I both at one time together thought that word perused meant just quickly read quick. Just look at it real quick. The word perused means examine. It means spend a lot of time with and labor over. And so I'll say that again. He read and perused many books and volumes. He filled them with handwritten notes and had many favorites that I could list. But I know two that were especially precious to him. I've already mentioned Matthew Henry, Matthew Poole. He had commentaries by B.B. Warfield, John Calvin. I had 3,000 books in his library at least. But there were two books that were very precious to him. One was called Not by Chance by Leighton Talbert. It's a Bob Jones University Press. Wonderful book to read. Not by chance. Nothing happens by chance. The second book was The Sovereignty of God by A.W. Pink. That's a rough one, but it's biblical. And David loved that book and read it oftentimes. Anyone who knew David at all would know that he believed and taught the biblical truth of God's sovereignty, that God is in control of all things. No matter what happens in this world, God is present and doing it by his own hand according to his will. Now, folks, I want to tell you, Susan, David's wife, his family, I want to tell you folks who've come to this gravesite chapel, God has given us very clear affirmation of his presence and also a confirmation and assurance that he himself is and has been present with us and lovingly taking David home. How does that happen? You see, extremely skilled doctors and medical teams were totally puzzled, and they called it a mystery and really had no clear explanation as to what was happening to David Vucish. Susan told me just a little while ago, a few days ago, that some of the Doctors stayed on the case longer than they would normally because it intrigued them and became a challenge to them. Oh, they diagnosed transverse myelitis. They said maybe Guillain-Barre's syndrome, or Guillain-Barre's is spelled, but it's said Guillain-Barre syndrome. They came up with fungal meningitis. White blood cells went crazy in his body, and they checked for blood cancer and multiple myeloma, which is bone marrow cancer. They talked about autoimmune diseases. They wanted to keep running tests. And they finally concluded and wrote on the death certificate that it was Guillain-Barre's syndrome that took David. However, the doctors never had any explanation of why he was so severely ill, folks, from all of the above things that I listed. You see, because normally, every one of those things that I listed is treatable. Jamie, my son's wife, who's a nurse, knows a few people had Guillain-Barre's disease, syndrome. I call it disease syndrome. And they had a few of these blood purgings and left the hospital and went on to normalcy. When I read about it, it said 2% people are afflicted with it for the rest of their life, or something happens to them. They might get crippled somewhat from it, or whatever, but 2%, I mean, these things are all treatable, and these doctors knew it, but something was making him severely ill and taking his life. You know what that was? It was God's day for David, amen? It's appointed unto man once to die. It's appointed. You have an appointment. God knows the day, the hour, the second, right down to the minutiae detail. I got another message I'll preach someday. And I tell my kids all the time, don't you dare ever say, well, it was a terrible accident that took our daddy. If I get in the car wreck, if I fall out of a tree stand, if I fall over a cliff, if I'm 200 yards down the woods and somebody shoots me through the head, it's not an accident. Never an accident. God is sovereign in all things, and you've got to get that, folks, or you're not going to make it in this life. It's appointed. Job 14:1, man that is born of a woman is a few days and full of trouble. He cometh forth like a flower and is cut down. He fleeth also as a shadow and continueth not. Seeing his days are, do you know what it says? You're not going to answer me, I'm going to have you turn. You got to turn. Job 14:5, you got to see this and you got to mark in your Bible and you got to know it. It's very important, folks, that you know this. Job 14:5, this is the Bible. Job 14, by seeing his days are what? Job 14, by right about the middle of your Bible.
Determined.
His days are determined. Your day, my day, is determined. David Vucish's day is determined. Yeah. The number of his months are with thee. That's God. Thou hast what?
Appointed
his bounds that he cannot pass. You ain't going to make it a minute past or a minute early. You're going to get there right on time. And it ain't going to be an accident. And neither was for my friend, Brother Vucish. Psalm 31:15 says, my times are in thy hand. I think it's been made clear in the Bible. And though I say to the family, and you who've come here to this graveside chapel, though we are very hard to be comforted at this time, this is indeed our confidence, our comfort, and our rest. I want to close with this. But you see, as I prayed about these messages, I kept being haunted that two preachers wanted to preach. Two preachers. And I didn't know how that was going to work out. You see, not too long ago, folks, I listened to a message that my friend preached on February the 8th, 1998, at Big Strictly Baptist Church, where he once pastored. And I prayed long and hard as God burdened me to do what I'm about to do. I believe the Lord would have me to share not my conclusion to this matter, but one of David's. Two preachers want to preach today. The same two guys that said they're going to drool and holler at each other and scream and yell and all the rest. I believe this is what God would have me to do. And I believe this is what David would want me to do. I recently listened to a message that he preached from John chapter 14. I will close with this. But what I'm about to do is read to you word for word the manuscript that my brother put together. This is his message, not mine. This is his day. This is the day that we're celebrating his coming to be with the Lord. And my brother David said, turn to John chapter 14, verses 1 through 4. Let's read. Let not your heart be what, folks?
Troubled.
That's what David said. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And whither I go, you know, and the way you know. From this point to the end of this message is David now preaching to you. Let not your heart be troubled. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. You see that term, my Father's house? That's heaven. You know, in the New Testament, there are several terms that are used to refer to a place called heaven. Heaven is called a country. Heaven is called a city. Heaven is called paradise. Heaven is referred to in several ways in the New Testament. You know the one I like the most? This one. My Father's house. If it's Jesus' Father's house, it's our Father's house too. You know that I can say today that when I die, I'm going to my Father's house? I pray, our Father, my Father, which art in heaven. God is my Father if I know Jesus Christ is Son. My Father's house. You know what? You know what my Father's place is? That's home. And I want to tell you today, ain't no place like home. Amen. You know who's at home? Family. Loved ones. My daddy's there. My mama's there. Family's there. Ain't no place like home. I'm glad to be in other people's homes as a visitor. But there ain't no place like home. Am I right? You like to go on vacation, even like as a break, staying in some motel. Ain't no place like home. Ah, not quite as good as that. And sometimes miserably, you like to go to relatives' homes. And ah, you know, guests are like fish after a few days. But then you can't wait to get home. Ain't no place like home. Home. You know what heaven is? It's our home. That's our home. Ah, we haven't seen it, but that's our home. You know what there is in heaven? In my Father's house are many mansions. That's what it says. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop. And he tried to sing, but Brother David could never sing. He could preach, but he could not sing. And he began to sing, I've got a mansion, which we know ever so well in this church, just over the hilltop. Many mansions. You know what that means? There's enough room for the whole family. Are you part of the family of God? Plenty of room for you to come. For you. Come on up. Someday we're going to have the marriage supper. Man, what a gathering that's going to be. All Italian food. From one end of eternity to the other. 5,000 mile long table. And there's going to be lasagna. And gnocchi. And bruschetta. And rigatoni. And linguine. I could go on and on and on. Oh, what a supper. Come on home. Come on home. It's supper time. Heaven. You know what's in heaven? It's our home. That's our home. How do we know? How do we know these things? You say, preacher, I've heard this stuff, but how do I really know it's true? Because Jesus said. Look what it says, verse 2. If it were not so, I would have told you. Somebody says, I don't believe in this heaven stuff. Jesus said, if there wasn't a heaven, I'd have told you. The one who cannot lie, who would not lie, who has never lied. Let God be true and every man a liar. Jesus would never lie. If Jesus said there's a home, and in that home there are many mansions, plenty of room for you and I, then mark it down. There is. If he says there is many mansions, I believe him. Why? He said it. Would he lie? Of course not. If it wasn't so, he would have told us. Then look what it says. I go to prepare a place for you. Isn't it marvelous? You say, maybe everybody else gets these mansions, but I'm just going to get a little shack. No. He said, in my Father's house there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. One of those places is mine. Ha! I like that. I like that. And I'll guarantee you one thing. It's nicer than anything we got here. Oh, man, what's it going to be like? You know, what's amazing about the New Testament and the doctrine of heaven, folks? We don't know a lot about it. Do you know we know more, way more about hell than we do about heaven? God gives every little detail of hell. He describes people who are in hell. He talks about their screams and their torment. He tells you every little detail. Why? He don't want you to go there. But with heaven, he just sort of whets our appetite. He says, in my Father's house, there are many mansions. And I want to say to him, is there rugs? How many rooms? You learned enough. It's good enough just to know it's a mansion. And hey, if Jesus is the architect and builder, I'd assume it's going to be pretty good. Amen. Aren't you having fun today? Isn't God good? Say, how do you know, preacher? Because Jesus said so. You want to doubt his word? Take one of these smart aleck people who think they know more than God. Say, I don't believe it. I think when you die, you just go into the earth. And there's no eternity. We're just evolution, you know. We're just come from animals, and that's it. That's it. Well, the smart aleck knows more than Jesus knows, doesn't it? Are you telling me that some peanut head professor down at Pitt University knows more than Jesus Christ? I think not. I think the one who created the entire universe and in him is hid all the wisdom and knowledge forever knows more than some professor. You having fun? Man. Let not your heart be troubled. Why? Why? Because of who Jesus is. Why? Because of where he went. Look, Jesus said he's going to heaven. I believe it. Jesus said that in heaven there are many mansions. I believe him. He said it. Jesus said he was going to go and prepare a place for me. I believe him. That's what he said. Let not your hearts be troubled. Why? Because of who he is. Why? Because of where he went. Why? Because of what he promised to do. Look at verse 3. And if I go to prepare a place for you, look at the next four words. I will come again. We sang about it today. And I'm going to say that they sang some song about that probably that morning. I will come again. Make no mistake, ladies and gentlemen. Jesus is coming again. He will return for us. That's a promise directly from the lips of the one who has never lied. My friends, David Vucish is doing a whole lot better than we are today. Amen. And I'm sure his words to us today, Susan, Rebecca, Michelle, David, and those of you who love him so much, his words would be, let not your hearts be troubled. Psalm 30 verse 5 says, weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. But that's only if you're saved, like Brother David was. That's only if you received Christ, like Brother David did when he was 18 years old. Have you come to that place where you've trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ? Not in religion, not in baptism, not in some good deeds you did. If you could get to heaven by doing good deeds, then why in the world did Jesus Christ come into this world, live 33 years in this world, despised, rejected of men, take the spittle of men in his face, take the brutal beating that he took, and hang on that wicked, rugged cross? Why did he do it if he could just do good things and get there? He did it because there's no way to get there but by the blood of Jesus Christ. It cleanses from all sin. Now there's some of you here today who Brother David loved dearly. He's told you this message, and he's told you this message, and he's told you this message. And you know what? God might have taken him home so that you'd be here today and finally wave the white flag and give it all to the Christ that saved and keeps and now is in the presence of, David is now in the presence of him even the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you know where you're going to die when you go to do you know where you're going to go when you die? Will you go to heaven? David knew he was gone. And I'm sure as I'm standing there, he's there as we speak. And he's not worried about us at all. But if he had it to say, he would say, let not your heart be troubled. If you're saved, if you know that when you die, you're going to be reunited with him. But if you're not sure of that, I beg you, I plead with you, settle that today. Father, we thank you for our brother David. Just a man, Lord. A man that you've saved and done a mighty work in. We thank you, Lord, for the work you've done in many of our hearts, but we're most concerned for those in this place who may not know him, who is life eternal. I pray your spirit would convict folk greatly this day, that you would be real in their hearts today, Lord, that you'd draw men unto yourself as only you can, that you'd save the lost by your grace. And then, Lord, help us as believers and your children, part of your family, to pick up the baton that Brother David left to us and run as your word exhorts us to. Help us, Father, to live for you and realize that there's nothing worth living for in this world but Jesus Christ. May we serve you and do your will and accomplish that which you have for us as we approach that day that you have determined, that you have appointed for each and every one of us. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Heads are bowed. Eyes are closed. Nobody's looking around. Most important question I can ask this night is, do you know you're saved? Do you have assurance that if you were to die, you'd be reunited with Brother David Vucish and everybody else that's going ahead? Lou Swingle, Selwyn Schmidt, Bob Snyder. We could just go down to many. Gladys D'Alessandro, Mary Warner. Pastor talks about these often. They're waiting for us if we're saved. Do you know you're going to be reunited? Do you really have that assurance? If you're not sure, then tonight, right where you stand, say yes to the Lord Jesus Christ, who said yes to the cross for your sins, and he will save you. He said, him that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. He will not cast you out. Now, I look like I'm talking to most people here that are saved, but I never know. I don't know your heart. I got no idea what's inside of you. People are complicated. Human beings, they can fool you. Human beings are very complicated. And the older I get, the more I think they're complicated, even the more. And so you can fool me, but you can't fool God. Are you saved tonight? Then, I hope, though some of you don't even know David Vucish, I wish you could know him. What a blessing. Though you don't even know him, would you realize that God wants you to pick up the baton? You're saved, you're in the race, you're running, you're enduring, you're ready not to quit, you're ready to serve the Lord and do his will, you're willing and ready to do whatever God has you to do, humbly, not being full of pride. What are you accomplishing for the Lord? Will you receive that crown when you stand before him, give account of your life? Do you have any fruit at all since you've been saved? I wonder. Only you know that, folks. That's between you and God. I know many of you are saved, but that's the kind of questions you need to ask tonight. Do I have the baton in my hand? Am I running? Am I in the race? Am I doing the will of God by the grace of God, according to the Word of God? If you're not sure, then talk to the Lord about that. Say, Lord, I want to do your will, according to your will and your word. Help me to that end. I want to do that which would be pleasing to you and serve you. Maybe God raised somebody in here up as a preacher. I'll tell you, that young man's impressed me that day, and I haven't heard a kid like that for a long time. I'm looking forward to seeing him again. I'll be in touch with him. Pray for him. Pray for him that he'll carry on in the direction he's in right now. He's just like a lost sheep. Brother Vucish is gone. He didn't know what to do. And he's asked me to, if I could give him some direction and help. You pray that I'll give him the right information and encourage him to serve the Lord and do his will. I'm not going to give the invitation. I've kept you long enough. I appreciate your time. I appreciate you listening to this message that God laid upon my heart to bring at the funeral of my dearest friend in life. I think there's a lot in the message that you can learn from and glean from. I'm going to ask my brother, in law. I told Brother Bissell, I'm going to say it again, Brother Vucish is my best friend outside of my family. Brother, this is my family. His kids got my blood in them. Amen? And so we're very close. I'm going to ask him to come and close this service, however God leads him. I know it's late and I know it's cold outside. But think about some things tonight, folks. Decisions need to be made in all of our lives. I need to be more faithful. We all need to be more faithful. We need to run that race. And if you're not sure you're saved, you need to get sure. Brother Bissell, please close our service.
That's what it's all about. We are going to face the Lord. One of the man wants to die and then the judgment. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for each one here. And just pray you bless this memorial message as we remember the life of Brother David Vucish. Thank you for the exhortation, the reminiscing, and the verses and testimony and messages that excerpts of messages of Brother Vucish preached.
Amen.
Just bless you now, and we'll thank you for all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
May we just all stand together in closing hymn.